All right. Well, good evening, everyone. Welcome to the kickoff of the 111th annual meeting of the Green Mountain Club. My name is Mike Devonis. I'm the executive director of the GMC, and I'll be your host tonight. In case you aren't familiar with the Green Mountain Club, we've been around for over 100 years, first as an organization centered around building the Long Trail, and now one that cares for more than 500 miles of hiking trails in Vermont, including the Long Trail, its side trails, the Appalachian Trail in Vermont, and the Kingdom Heritage Trails in the Northeast Kingdom. If you hike in Vermont, there's a good chance you've been on a trail that's maintained by the Green Mountain Club. We're really excited to have Derick Lugo here as our annual meeting speaker. And before I introduce and hand things over to Derick, I want to provide a quick overview of the schedule and technology for tonight. Derick will speak for about 30 to 40 minutes, and then we'll have time for questions. Please use the question and answer feature at the bottom of your screen. If you click on the Q&A icon, you'll be able to type a question for Derick. And we'll try to get through as many of the questions as we can before the end of the program. So without further ado, it is my pleasure to welcome Appalachian Trail thru-hiker, author, and storyteller Derick Lugo. Whether you've hiked the whole trail, been on day hikes, or never heard of the AT, Derick, through his writing and storytelling, has a way of making the Appalachian Trail come alive. So sit back and enjoy. Derick, thank you so much for being with us tonight.
Thank you for having me, guys. First, I want to thank the Green Mountain Club for having me. It's a pleasure to be here. I am the author of The Unlikely Thru-Hiker, and the story is of my thru-hike of the Appalachian Trail in 2012. And unlike most of you guys, I had no hiking experience when I first decided, or when I first got on the trail to through hike. I've never camped out, never pitched a tent. I've never seen the wilderness, never slept out in a tent. The only thing I knew, let me share actually my screen so you guys can see this. There we go. There we go. All right. So the only thing I knew was this was my wilderness, New York City. All I knew as far as the outdoors, Central Park was the biggest thing I knew, the most I knew about the wilderness. These were my markers. And this was how I got around. And this was the wildlife. So you're probably wondering then, how did I find out about the AT? How did I find myself through hiking the Appalachian Trail? Well, I'm a huge reader. And someone handed me this book that said, hey, read this book. It's funny. You're going to like it. They didn't say anything about the AT. They just said, it's funny. I read it. And yeah, because I like funny. I read it and it was hilarious. But the one thing that stuck out was this trail that Bill Bryson made sound so hard. And to me, it was a challenge. And like, almost like a pipe dream, I wanted to do the AT, like traveling around the world, running a marathon. I wanted to do the AT, but wasn't sure I was going to do it. And the only thing, everything I knew about the AT was from that book. So I knew it went from Georgia to Maine, 14 states, 2,200 miles. That was it. That's all I knew. But I really wanted to do it. So I started sharing it with my family and friends saying, hey, I'm going to hike the Appalachian Trail. And this was the reaction I would get. This is the look I would get. So this is Nina. If you read my book, The Unlikely Thru-Hiker, this is her, Nina. So this is her. I'm actually going to read her reaction when I told her I was going to hike the Appalachian Trail. Okay, why would you want to do that? She says, frowning. What? Because I can't. Because I've never done anything like this before, I say. is she messing with me? It's an adventure, something I wanted to do for a while. You never mentioned it to me before, she shoots back, as if catching me in a lie. I'm sure I did. Look, that's not the point. What are you gonna eat? Will you have self-service so you can order food? Do they deliver out there? She barrages me with questions, ignoring my efforts to explain. I will bring a cell for when I'm in town resupplying. And if there's an emergency, I'll be on top of mountains, which I think will be outside of delivery and maybe cell service. I say, not truthfully knowing the answer. I don't know about this. How long would it take you? She asks, unable to grasp the thought of me doing something so out of character. I'm gonna try to do it in 5 months, I say proudly. You're going to live in the mountains for 5 months, she repeats, squinting her eyes at me as if I were too far away for her to see. Before I can answer, she continues, listen, pretty boy, I know you. You are the most well-groomed metrosexual Black man in New York City. You in the woods without your mirror and your beauty products or your designer clothes, please. How will you shower? Wait, I don't have beauty products. Okay, maybe lotions. What about manicures? Okay, I get manicures once in a while. Okay, I get it. I say, wanting to finally get my point across before she convinces me I'm too meticulous about my appearance to live out in the woods. So that was the reaction I got from my friends. My friends thought I was too cityfied. My family thought I was a little crazed. And my brother, well, he was like, look, dude, you're my big brother, but I don't want you to do this. You shouldn't be doing this. I feel like I need to like talk to you, like talk you down the ledge. Cause he thought I was just going to go out and just get in trouble. He said, look, man, if you got to do it, take a machete with you. They come in small sizes and you can just strap it to your chest and you go. And I said, dude, I can't take a machete. I'm not going to do it. Cause there's a big difference between a hiker, a thru hiker in the wilderness, and a dude with a machete in the wilderness. And you know what's worse? This dude with a machete in the wilderness. You know how long it took me to Photoshop that? It took a while. So my family didn't want me to go. My brother was like, no, but they couldn't change my mind. And I finally got their blessings, or I should say their warnings. So after I decided I was going to do it, didn't matter what they said, I had to get gear because the moment I decided I was going to thru hike, within a week and a half, 2 weeks, I was on the trail. So I went to an outfitter. I ran into the outfitter and the first person I saw, I said, I'm thru hiking the Appalachian Trail. Can you help me get some gear? And she turns around and she says, well, that's nice, but I don't work here. So I was so excited. I didn't know she didn't work there. So I went. Found someone that actually worked at the outfitter. And luckily, he had thru-hiked the year before. And he was able to help me get all my gear. And he asked me, all right, so what kind of backpack do you normally wear? Like, what do you like? And I said, well, I don't know. I've never hiked before. And he said, well, you're telling me that you've never hiked before, and now you're going to attempt a 2,200 mile thru hike of the Appalachian Trail. I said, yeah, why not? People do that, right? Why not? He's like, okay. He's like, all right, fool. He didn't say that, but I can always read his mind. So he helped me get all the gear, most of my gear. As I'm leaving the store, I turn around and I can almost read his mind. He's like, this dude is going to get himself hurt. But again, no one could change my mind. I said, I'm going to do this. It's going to happen. So, and also I didn't even know if I liked hiking. I just knew my goal was to get from Georgia to Maine. And this is the approach trail. And I've seen photos of this and maybe a video of it once or twice. It's pretty iconic. The approach trail, this stone archway. And when I got there, and I'm standing in front of it, I get a pain in my stomach. I'm like, what am I doing out here? I have all this gear that I don't know how to use. I didn't get a chance to test it. I think I pitched in my tent once in my bedroom, and I wasn't even sure if I did it right, because something was a little off. And I'm like, I'm going to attempt this. But again, I had nowhere to go. I had planned this to be out in the wilderness for 5 to 6 months. I had nowhere else to go. And I just decided, you know what? Just as fast as that feeling came, I went ahead and just took that first step, and it was gone. So I hiked to Springer Mountain that first day. That first day, there's a lot of people out there. I think when I first wrote my book, 25% of the people that attempt to hike the Appalachian Trail actually finish it. But and I was thinking that how many people are thinking like me, like, hey, I'm gonna go all the way. I'm assuming all of them, or they wouldn't have attempted or tried or started. So I get to Springer Mountain. It's 8 miles up these steps that I almost passed away from it. Get to Springer Mountain, and I go to pitch my tent. And this is not my actual tent, but this is kind of what it looked like. This one of the first chapters in my book is called Lessons at Springer Mountain, because the things that I should have learned how to do or use, like the gear and all that I should have learned months, if not years ago, I was learning that day. So I'm struggling with my tent. I can't get the tent flies down because the stakes won't go into the ground. I'm like, what am I going to do? But I'm still trying. This other thru-hiker sees me struggling. He grabs a rock, taps down all the stakes, looks at me, tosses the rock, and walks away. And I go, dude, you are a genius. So I grabbed the rock and I put it in my backpack because I need to use it for it. No, I'm kidding. I didn't do that. But it was one of those lessons that I was learning on the trail. So that day I learned how to use my stove, my mini stove. I remember when I first lit it, I used an alcohol stove. When I first lit it, my dreads was hanging and it popped, and I had to pull back because I was like, oh, I'm gonna catch my dreads. I was like, what did I get myself into? So I learned how to use my mini stove, my water filter. I learned how to hang my food bag, because you need to hang your food bag every night because of bears. And I learned how to pitch my tent. So that night I went to bed at 7:30 at night. And that's, for me, a New Yorker, I'm a night owl. That was super early, but I was exhausted, because when was the last time I hiked 8 miles with a 42, I think it was, pound backpack, and going up these 750 steps at the approach trail? I've never done that before. And I'm thinking I'm in great shape. I got this. But no, this is totally, totally different. So I was out. I went to bed at 7:30 at night. And I thought I was going to be up all night, because I'm from New York City and the sounds of the city is what I'm used to. I'm used to the car horns, alarm, people fighting outside. These are the sounds that actually put me to sleep. So I'm thinking, oh man, I'm out in the wilderness. There's creatures out here, creatures that live out here, and aliens and like Bigfoot and all these things. But as soon as I put my head down, I was out. 7:30, I was out. I woke up 7:30 in the morning. Everyone, by the time I got out of my tent, everyone was up already for like an hour. People were leaving. I ended up leaving 2 hours after everyone else because I didn't know how to put everything back. Like, I wasn't sure how it should go. I was kind of struggling with that. And also, I'm not an early riser at all. So I just was like, okay, you guys go on ahead and I'll catch up if I can. If not, I had my destination where I was going to go. So that first day was the first day that I hiked by myself, because the day before there was a lot of people that started. So it was kind of like, you know, I was struggling, but there was a lot of people around. So I wasn't really too spooked. But I started by myself, but all I knew is that I need to follow this blaze. I said, look, there's this marking on a tree that I know that are on trees, on rocks, on bridges. I knew if I follow that, I'm good. And I knew that the rule of thumb was that if you're standing right next to one blaze, you should be able to see another one, which wasn't really true. There was times when I was on a trail, I didn't see a blaze. But for a trail that's 2,200 miles long, most of the AT, you're good with the blazes. You're really good. So I was like, okay, I got this. I'll just follow this white marker and I can do this. But then it was this blue one, which I wasn't sure about. And I got lost a few times. Turns out that this blue blaze takes you to water sources, to shelters, to side trails, and to, you know, like other trails. So I had to, in my head, I had to understand that I'm not supposed to be following that blue blaze unless I was going to a shelter or to a privy or to a water source. So, okay, I was like, all right, cool. I'll follow the white blaze. I got this. But then when I started, oh, let me back up a little bit. I'm going ahead. Okay, but once I started the trail, all these sounds that were just, it were like squirrels running on dry leaves, sounded like a stampede of boars to me. I was getting spooked. And then looking down the distance, I would see like logs and trees and stuff that were like down, but they looked like dragons and like creatures to me. So my mind started playing tricks on me. So I'm thinking it's going to be easy, just follow the blaze. But now I'm hiking by myself and all the sounds of the wonderful wilderness are scaring this New Yorker. You know, if I would have heard a car sound or like people arguing, I would have felt at home. But these sounds that are just these beautiful sounds to me were foreign and I was spooked. But within a few days, because the AT in the beginning is so, like I said, so crowded with people. Once I got to a campsite, it was packed with a lot of other thru-hikers. So within a few days, I found myself hiking with this group of beautiful hikers. And I decided to name the group the Moving Village because when we pitch our tent, it looks like a village. And then the next day we pack them up and we move, hence the Moving Village. I thought I was a genius when I came up with that name. But so we ended up being the Moving Village. We hiked together for about a month. Normally when you're hiking with a group, things happen. People get injured, people, you know, either hike faster or slower. So you don't typically stay with the same group. But in my head, I felt like we could all, this solid group could summit Mount Katahdin together. And that was my dream. Within a week, everyone in this photo right here had a trail name except for me. So they decided, okay, Derick, when we get into camp tonight, we are going to have a powwow and we're going to get to know you a little bit more. That way we can give you a trail name. So by the way, trail names are names you get on the trail when you're through hiking because you're doing something incredible out of the ordinary and then, you know, outside of the quote unquote real world. So you get kind of like a new name, new persona on the trail. And normally a trail name is either the way you look, something you say, something you did, and someone else will name you. And you don't have to take the first name that's given to you. Cause they were trying to give me a bunch of different names. And I was like, nah. So first of all, I don't know why Captain Jack Sparrow wasn't my trail name. Look at this guy. I look like a pirate. So I shared a little bit about myself. I said, walking into this, I wanted to stay fresh and clean because I've heard stories of thru hikers not bathing for weeks, sometimes a month or two. I said, no, that ain't going to be me. I'm going to stay fresh and clean. I brought like a shave. I was going to shave like at streams. I was going to like give myself bird baths. I brought like a camp towel. Like I was going to stay fresh and clean. Didn't matter. I even had wipes. I had wipes that if I couldn't get to a stream or I didn't have any kind of water source, I was going to like at least wipe up a little bit. And then I joked around about how I told Nina that I wish I could bring a full length mirror with me so I can like fold it up. Put it in my back and pull it out and kind of groom myself. And one of the hikers was like, oh my God, oh my gosh, you're a Mr. Fabulous. And I said, Mr. Fabulous, I can't go around calling myself Mr. Fabulous. He said, no, one, Mr. Fabulous was the trumpet player for the movie, the Blues Brothers movie. And he was the suave trumpet player. And also because of your experience, because you have no experience, you're from New York City. And by then it was like a week into our through hike and I was doing pretty well. And he said, well, you're Mr. Fabulous, man, you got this. And I said, no, there's no way I'm going to go up to someone and say, hi there, I'm Mr. Fabulous. I'm like, that is creepy. And he said, yeah, man, if you say it like that, don't say it like that. So he convinced me to use the trail name for, you know, so he said, look, use it for a few days, see how it fits, if you like it. And I said, okay, I'm gonna use the trail name Mr. Fabulous. So every time, and my reaction, I felt like the reaction I was going to get from people was, once they heard my trail name, they were gonna go, yeah, you know, well, why are you Mr. Fabulous? Like, well, what's up with that? But that wasn't the reaction I got. The reaction was more of curiosity. I got smiles and laughter once I told them, you know, the story. And I started getting pretty comfortable with it. But the one story I would share that actually sealed the deal, where I was like, okay, I'm going to use the Mr. Fabulous trail name, because for the first few times I was almost apologizing to people that my trail name was Mr. Fabulous. They're like, what's your trail name? I'm like, well, I mean, they call me Mr. Fabulous, but I didn't name myself. I'm sorry, you know, and, you know, and again, it was just like all good. But the one day where I was hiking by myself and there was an elderly group doing a day hike, there's maybe like a dozen of them, and I stepped aside because they were going south, I was going north. I stepped aside, we chatted a little bit, they heard I was through hiking and they were wishing me luck and stuff like that. And the last person, she was older than them, she was a lot older, she must have been like 150 200 years old. She was older than the Appalachian Trail, because she was like small, had a cane, she had an aide with her. She came up to me, she was like this cute thing, and first thing that came out of her mouth, she asked me, so what's your trail name? And I said, ma'am, my trail name is Mr. Fabulous. And without missing a beat, she says, oh my gosh, I've been waiting for Mr. Fabulous my entire life. And she reaches up, like pulls my face down, gives me a kiss on my cheek, and storms off with like her cane with a little pep in her step. And her aide is like chasing after her. I'm like, wow, that's incredible. Mr. Fabulous is kind of like the cure to like aging, you know, like you want to feel young. So from that moment, I decided that I was going to keep the trail name, not because of me, not because I thought I was Mr. Fabulous. To this day, I don't think I'm Mr. Fabulous. It's just the story it brings, how it makes people feel. Because throughout my entire through hike, I would hear someone would see me like, Mr. Fabulous. And I know it made them feel really good to say Mr. Fabulous, you know? And you know what? I'm sticking with that story because it's not about me. That's the truth. Another lesson, I learned a lot of lessons on the trail. One of the lessons I learned on the trail was from this guy. His trail name is Birdman. First, I have to say that, doesn't he look like a lawn gnome? That's with the beard and the red light. He's got a great smile. One of the nicest guys on the trail that the season that I did it. And as soon as he saw me, he started taking photos of me. And I was like, okay. And he said, hey, let's take a photo together. We took photos. And he said, he started sharing a story with me that he said he met a through hiker, someone that through hiked the year before. And he asked that through hiker, if there's one thing you could do differently, what would it be? And the through hiker said that he took a lot of photos of trees, mountains, sky, you know, grass, any greenery he saw, but he wished he took more photos of people. And as soon as he said that, I didn't have to hear the rest of it. It made a lot of sense, because you could be on top of a mountain, you could see a beautiful scenery with all the mountains, and you take a photo of it, but those emotions, those feelings, that sensation you had up there, you can't really capture that with the camera. But if you take a photo of a person, like this photo right here, you could remember the conversation you had with that person. Like that, I remember the moment I had with him. I remember the lesson he taught me. I remember his trail name because of this photo. I remember all the sweet things that this beautiful human being said to me. So from that moment on, I started taking photos of everyone. I was just like, kaka, kaka. I wasn't creepy about it. I wasn't like going up to be like, hey, but I would take photos of trail angels. Trail angels are people that help out hikers with trail magic, which is like giving them a ride into town or leaving food for them. Because we thru-hikers, we burn a lot of calories. We were hiking every day. We hike from morning to night. We're burning thousands of calories and we're never going to replace it as much as we try. So we're always hungry. And so I took photos of trail angels. I would take photos of hikers I met along the way, a lot of selfies. So that was one of the lessons that I took with me. And it also helped with my writing because I went from the first draft, I took it from memory. Second draft, I took from my journal. And then the third one was photos. And sometimes when I was doing the first draft, I would have a photo that reminded me of the story I was going to tell. So it was very helpful that way. There was a lot of reasons why I was an unlikely thru-hiker. You would think one of them is these bandanas. What's up with those bandanas? This wasn't a thing that I decided to do. I started with one bandana and then I found a new one at a shelter and then someone else gave me another one. So it just happened. This look is fun. I miss looking like this, first of all. There's two things actually that I can't do when I went back to New York that I couldn't do. I couldn't go back looking like this unless I was juggling in Central Park or something like that. There's no way unless I was performing. Also, I couldn't call myself Mr. Fabulous. Trust me, I tried. Nina was not, she was not having it. But like I said, it was more reasons why I was unlikely. It was that I didn't have any experience, one. Two, being from the big city, it was the first time I've seen a small town was when I was through hiking. Also, being able to adapt really fast and use the gear that I should have learned a long time ago, and it all of a sudden became second nature to me. Well, not all of a sudden, it took a few days, but I would say after the second time I used the gear, I was good. And also, looking like myself, being a person of color, and that was something I didn't even know was a thing. Like I walked into this because I'm from New York City, the melting pot of the world, and I have friends from all over the place. And for me, it never crossed my mind. And people were coming up to me saying, oh my gosh, I'm so glad you're on the trail. Thank you for being on the trail. And I'm like, well, thank you for being on a trail. Oh my gosh, you're out here. Not understanding what they were saying that. And then eventually it would make it clear to me that I was the only person that on the trail, and it turned out I was the only person of color on the trail that season. And for me, it was sad because I didn't want to believe it. So the next few days, I would look for someone that kind of looked like me, and I couldn't see anyone. I think throughout my entire trail, my thru-hike, 6 months on the Appalachian Trail, I saw maybe two people of color and they were doing day hikes and it was their first time on a trail. So halfway through my hike, people saw that I had a passion. I fell in love with the AT because remember, I didn't know if I liked hiking and turned out I loved it. So that helped a lot. But I always told myself, I don't know if I'm going to like it. And if I don't, I don't care. I'm going to just hike because that's my goal. It was a challenge for me. And I'm glad I did fall in love with it because now, you know, I have a story to share. I have this amazing story. I have a love for it and I have a passion. I've been talking about it for years. So halfway through my thru hike, knowing this, It wasn't, my story is not about, hey, I'm a Black dude that thru-hiked the Appalachian Trail. I'm a unicorn. Look at me. No, no. It's about me sharing my story, sharing the love I got, the help, and how people treated me. It was just nothing but love, no judgment. And that's what this book is about. This book is about, well, two things I would say, but there's a lot of layers to it. One was this hiking community that I walked into that I knew nothing about and how I was embraced. And also just stepping out of your comfort zone, doing something out of the ordinary and living your dream. That's what this book is about. So some people, when they read my book, they want me to talk about certain states. And I think I covered every state. But people say, why didn't you hit Vermont? Like, why didn't you talk about Vermont? I'm like, I'm pretty sure I talked about Vermont because Vermont was actually one of my favorite states. I'm going to say right now, I don't know if that was a question that was going to be thrown out there, but I'm going to share it now, that Vermont was without a doubt my favorite state. And I know I wrote about it. And this photo right here is actually, the trail, the side trail that you need to take to get to the Killington peak view. And that day I was hiking and I felt like I was dehydrated. I felt sick and it was just a bad day. And I was hiking with two other hikers and they said, hey, we got to take this side trail to check out this view. So it's supposed to be the best view out there. And I said, I don't know, man, I'm not feeling that great. But I knew that I may not come this way again. So I decided to do it. I put my pack down in the shelter and we took lunch up and I climbed to the top and this was my view. And it didn't disappoint. This is no doubt. And again, pictures can't really capture the feelings that I had up there and what I saw. But this is without a doubt, and I knew that moment that this was the best. And I had already been on a trail for a hot minute, northern part of my journey. I knew without a doubt that this was the best view I've ever seen. And we had lunch up there, and these were the two hikers that convinced me to go up there. I could have easily stayed at the shelter and waited for them, but I knew, and it was a steep climb, but I knew I would have regretted if I didn't do it. What I want to share with you guys is my little part. It's not a little part, actually. It's a good part, a nice chunk of Vermont. Because people are like, Vermont's not in the book. And I'm like, oh, I beg to differ. So I'm just going to read a little section for you. So this is chapter 28. I call it The Most Wondrous Trail. We reach the Massachusetts-Vermont border, where the AT follows the long trail for 105 miles before the AT splits off toward Maine, and the long trail continues toward Canada. It's a wet and foggy day, and the rain comes and goes with no regard for us through hikers. Although the weather is icky, Vermont promises to be a beautiful state to hike. Well, that's what I heard. But they sang the same song about the Smokies, which were rough and cold as a bully. Vermont, please don't be a wicked beauty. So I had a rough experience with the Smokies, and I called the Smokies a wicked beauty because it was like an ex-girlfriend where she hot, she fine, but you can't be with her anymore. And every time, like, you know, she does you wrong, you know, you see her beauty. So on, and you're like, okay, all forgiven. So when I was on this in Smokies, like the Smokies was tripping me up and I would get to the top to summit. And then I said, oh, you're beautiful. I forgive you. And she kept tripping me up. I fell at one point, but that didn't happen in Vermont. And this is why I start this chapter thinking, okay, I hear you're beautiful, just like I heard the Smokies beautiful, but please be nice to me. And Vermont was very nice to me. So I wanted to add that in there because I know a lot of you guys are like from Vermont and stuff. And I just wanted to add that little story. Just so you know, I don't want to ruin the end for you, but I do finish hiking the Appalachian Trail. And I'm going to end it with this, the story of this photo. So when you're through hiking, one of the things you think about is what is going to be your summit photo, because you use the photo for postcards and stuff like that. And, you know, I'm thinking, you know, yeah, I'll have my trekking poles and I'll put them up like this on top of the sign and I'll be like an Avenger or something like that. And that day, I almost didn't bring my trekking poles. I ended up bringing them. But that day when I got to this old sign, worn sign, I forgot what I was going to do, started tearing up. Everyone sits on this. They're sliding down it, they climb it. People are just, it's dirty. It's a dirty, worn out sign. But what does everyone do? They kiss the sign. And I was like, I ain't kissing this sign. I'm crying all over it. My tears are on it. So I do grab my bandana, one of my bandanas, and I wipe it down. I do give it a quick kiss. But I hop on top of this. Everyone gave me my room because I was, if you read my book, I'm the last one to get to the top of Mount Katahdin and to the end of my through hike for a couple of reasons. But you got to read the book, so I'm not sharing that right now. But I get there, people give me my space, they give me my time with the sign. And the first thing I do is just sit on the sign. And I was on the trail for 6 months. This is all I did every day. And I'm finally at the spot where I wanted to be for 6 months that I'm thinking of, constantly thinking of, and people probably thinking I couldn't do it, something like this. But in me, I knew I could. And I'm sitting on top and I just embrace the world, embrace the experience, and a thru hiker just captured it perfectly. And that's what I started using to share with people, postcards and stuff like that. But when I see this photo and I talk about it, I get a little emotional. And yeah, so that is my story. Guys, I'm gonna continue sharing my love of the AT, and I may have some news for you guys that you might dig, and we can talk about it during the Q&A. But if you want to hear more, you want to follow my what I'm up to next and stuff like that, follow me on the Insta and also Facebook. And that's my website. If you want to check out, I have extra stories that I add to the website. So thank you very much, guys.
Thank you so much, Derick. That was awesome. Yeah, it really kind of transports you back. That was great. We do have a few questions, and I know we've got a little bit of time here. So I don't know what surprise you're talking about, but we got a question from Sam who was wondering if you have another book in the works or what's kind of happening there.
So I'm writing a lot. I'm writing articles. I'm writing short stories. So I did, I'm collaborating with other writers. I am writing a short story for a new book that's coming out next year, Campfire Stories. So I'm going to add a story to that. I have a short story coming out for a magazine next winter or early next year. But as far as another book, yes, I always have something up my sleeves. I'm writing actually two more. It just depends. And I also have a bunch of other projects. So when I wrote this book, no one knew about me. So I had the time to do it. So now, you know,
now the pressure's on.
But I want to also continue sharing my story and doing as much as I can. So I don't mind it. So yes, there is another book in the works or two.
And we got a question from Christine who was wondering if you have any other through hikes, planned? Are you continuing to do long distance hikes or?
So if you read my book, Shanti is in the book and she started the AT on her 50th. And we decided that for the 10-year anniversary of our through hike that we may do on the PCT. I don't think it's going to happen next year, because next year would be the 10-year anniversary. But I do eventually plan to do the PCT. But again, I'm in a different place than I was before. I can't just up and leave for 5 to 6 months because, again, I have a lot of projects, a lot of people that depend on me. Unless, that being said, unless I'm sponsored and I can continue sharing my story while I'm on the trail. And then eventually I would write another book about that adventure. And if I do the PCT, I might as well just go ahead and do the CDT, right? Just might as well just do it. Be a triple crowner, right?
And get all the gear. All right. I know this is a question everyone wants to know the answer to. What'd your mom have to say when you got home?
Mira, ¿por qué tú quieres eso? ¿Qué te pasa contigo? She like cursing at me in Spanish, like, mom. While she's giving me like a big plate of rice and beans, she's like, oh, you did it. I think my mom still doesn't understand what I did. I still don't think she understands it. My brother now, he went from, dude, you did some bad things that can happen to you in the woods to like, okay, if you can do it, I can do it. All of a sudden, my friends, my family, not all my family, but my friends, they're experts now. They go from like not even knowing how to pronounce the Appalachian Trail to like, hey, you know what? I got me some trail runners. Let's go, man. I got this. I'm like, come on. So yeah, my brother thought, he said, look, if you could do it, I can do it. And bought some gear and we went for this long hike. It's actually, the ATC ended up doing a short film on it. It's called Trail Brothers. You can find it on YouTube. And I hiked from New York City to the Appalachian Trail, which was about 50 miles. And it was my brother's first hike. And turns out he ain't a hiker. He's more of a camper. He'd rather just drive up to a camp and pitch a tent. He's good. I love to hike. I like to work my way to the camp. So you got to watch it because it's pretty funny. His reaction is just like, oh man, okay, I get it.
That's great. Folks are wondering, are you still in the city or have you moved on other places?
No. Last year, because of COVID, I decided that it would be best for me to move out of the city because I wanted to continue working on my outdoor stories, my brand. I couldn't do that if I was in a New York apartment and we were quarantined, you know. And we left in July. It's almost a year. July 1st, we landed in Asheville, North Carolina. Because they were warning us that the fall was going to be worse. And there was no way I could do what I'm doing now, sharing with people. I did so many talks through Zoom last year, because last year was going to be my book tour. And I was going to travel all over and I was going to meet people. And all of a sudden that stopped. But there was a blessing in disguise where I was able to do it through Zoom. So there's no way I was going to do Zoom in a New York apartment and say, hey, yeah, I'm an outdoors guy, but I'm in my apartment. I can't go anywhere. So I moved to Asheville, North Carolina, where I'm surrounded by mountains, and I'm kind of in a nice secluded area, and I have the freedom to actually do some outdoorsy stuff. And because it's good for my health also, because mentally it's better for me to share my story if I'm doing it and I'm feeling good about it, not if I'm home cooped up in an apartment.
You mentioned a video with your brother. We had a question about a documentary. I think someone saw you. And is that the documentary or is there?
No, there's a few, you know, I'm in a few things, people. there is a documentary called Flip Flop Flipping that I'm in. And then there's three of those movies. I'm in the second. I'm featured in the second one. And in the third one, I'm in the end. Cause he took he captured my summit, which is beautiful. Crying and everything, and on top when I did this, he captured it in the documentary. So but no, I'm talking about ATCs. It's my AT story series, and mine was the first short film. I think it's like 10 minutes or something like that, and it's called Trail Brothers.
Okay,
it's good. It's really good, guys. You got to watch it.
And we encourage everyone to read the book. It's great. But for folks that maybe haven't, wildlife encounters, any particular things that jump out from your through hike?
Is getting chased by a bear like kind of wild and
oh yeah, it counts. Yeah.
It counts. Yeah. I had this one experience where, well, not just one, I had a few. For some reason, bears, because they said bears run away when they see humans. That ain't happened with me. Bears were like, what's going on with this dude? Almost like, I've never seen a dude like that on the trail. Let me see. So they start following me. There was one time, the first time, everyone was seeing a bear and I wanted to see a bear. I'm from New York City, never seen a bear. I was like, I want to see a bear in person. So it was my fault because someone was like, I was hiking on the trail and I see a family of like, there's like two little girls and two dads. And I'm like, hey, what's going on? Because the girl looked kind of sad. She said, there's a bear right over there. And I was like, really? She's like, yeah, there's a bear. And I kind of like jump over her and I start chasing. I look back and she's like, don't go, what are you doing? It's a bear. So I run up and I see the bear, and the bear is maybe a few yards away from me. I grab my camera. I had a camera back then. It wasn't my phone. And I walked by, saw it. He had his back toward me and he was eating grub, and I was safe. But then I decided to come back because I was like, you know what? Let me get a little closer. Cause I want to get, that's how you get in trouble when you're like, let me get a little closer. It's fine. I got closer and the bear heard me, turned around, and he did something I didn't know bears could do. He hissed. I know. Did you know bears could hiss?
No.
He did some crazy, it didn't sound like a snake. It was like more like a vampire type, you know, like, I was like, I don't want to get turned by a, I want to be a vampire one day, but not by a bear. So I ran. And luckily people said that because he charged me, and people said it must've been a bluff charge. Cause there's no way you were going to outrun a bear. So, and also the trail kind of turned. So maybe he lost me or something, but yeah, I ran all the way to camp, to the next shelter, and they said, don't run. So when you see a bear, just make yourself big and don't run. I was like, the heck with that. I'm running. I'm from Brooklyn. I'm running.
that's crazy. Do you have like a toughest mile? Was there a particular stretch of the trail that was kind of a low pointer that was like particularly like the hardest?
Yeah. There were the Smokies wasn't, I didn't like the Smokies at all. I know people love the Smokies, and I'm not knocking the Smokies. In the book, you'll read it that I had a love-hate relationship with the Smokies. But again, I had a hard time with it was really cold up there. And it was one morning I woke up, and my peeps are from the tropics. So we don't like the cold. We like nice warm weather. And I knew I was gonna be hiking in cold weather and stuff. It's fine. But for some reason, the Smokies, like in the morning, it would rain and I'm putting my tent away and like packing everything up, and my fingers are just like, and I'm shaking, and it's just, every morning was a rough morning for me in the Smokies. And then I start my day and it warms up, and then I hit a summit and it's beautiful. And I'm like, oh, I love you again. And then I start, it's in the book. At one point I'm going down a hill and I hit a root and I fall. As I'm falling, it's almost like the Matrix, slow motion. And I go back and I turn around because I know I need to land on my back, not on my face. I land on my back like a turtle, and I'm just like, and then it's the dust and all that. And she just kept tripping me up. So I would say the Smokies, I was not a fan of the Smokies. And then there was one time when I hiked in a snowstorm where I thought I was done for.
So Randy's got a question. So a lot of people say that the Bill Bryson book inspired their own AT attempt. Has anyone told you that your book inspired them to hike? And then if so, what does that feel like?
Yeah. It's funny because I read Bill Bryson, and he's the reason why I know about the AT. And so that book inspired me. And throughout my thru-hike, people are like, yeah, Bill Bryson book inspired me. But the one thing thru-hikers say is that Bill Bryson didn't paint a pretty picture of the AT. He was so negative about it. But somehow, since his writing is so good, and it's a funny, funny book, that people were still inspired to do it. I said, I'm going to write a book like Bill Bryson's. It's going to be funny. I'm going to try to make it funny. But it's going to be positive. I want it to be positive. There's no way I'm going to convince my family or any friends or anyone that reads my book to hike the AT or go to the outdoors if it's all negative. I didn't want to do that. So that's why majority of it, it's honest, because that was my mindset when I walked into my thru hike, because I had so much going against me that I had to have I had to be positive. There was this mantra I have, peace, love, and all that good stuff. I had to have it because that was my strongest. That was the strongest thing I had to help me along the way. And then having the love for it and all that stuff, and meeting great people. But yeah, I get messages from people saying that they compare it to Bill Bryson's book, and I'm honored by it. They said, hey, this is just as good, if not better. We love how you approached it. So it went from me just sharing my story to now, you know, and I'm not going to lie to you. I'm gonna be transparent right now. I do go to Amazon to see how it's doing. And I noted, I do it. I'm sorry. sorry, but not sorry. And I noticed that Bill Bryson, it's always like 3, 4, 5. And Bill Bryson's book is the one that's on top of mind, because it's been around for like 20 years. So it's still like people still read it. And I'm hoping my book can do the same thing. But when I see it's like number two, some number three is or five, but Bill Bryson, I have his book, then his audio book, then his ebook. I'm like, just do one so I can be number two at least, you know? But yeah, I do. I'm honored. I answer all my emails. I love when people, yes, all my emails, all my messages, I make sure. I don't care how big I get, whatever, I'm going to always answer. It may take me a while, but I answer all of them. It's tough, but I do it because it's one of the reasons why I wrote the book, and people are inspired by it. And when they say, like, I read it to my kids, which is great because I make sure that it was kid friendly. I don't have any curses. I have made up words that sound like curses, like some of the Brooklyn Bridge and stuff like that. But I wanted to make sure that anyone can read this. So when parents say they read this to their kid and now their kids are curious and stuff, I love it. When I go to schools and do talks, I did a talk at this junior high, this middle school, seventh graders. The first talk I did at COVID, after COVID and all that. And we're at a big auditorium. So, you know, everyone was like that spaced out and all that. So we were safe. But afterwards, the kids were asking all these questions. They were like, you know, they were into it. And I remember I was walking out and a group of girls came to me and they were like, oh my God, it was great. Sign my mask, this and that. And they were like, we're sorry about the seventh grade class because we thought you were going to be boring. And I was like, what? I was like, okay, good. They're like, but you were amazing. So yes, when I hear that, I love it. I love it. And I do get that. And it's kind of weird for me to hear that, you know, it's like, you know, I was inspired by some, but you know, it's humbling. Yes. I love it.
Yeah. It's gotta be humbling. We've had a few questions kind of about what the transition was like for you when you got off the trail. Did you go right back home, and sort of what was that experience like for you, but also for, you know, your friends, and you know, if you did go back to the city?
Yeah, my transition was different than most thru-hikers because, like I said, halfway through my thru-hike, I decided I was going to write my book and I didn't want to go back to New York. There's a chapter in the book where I do go back to New York to like resupply, and just like I had like a hiker bash and stuff. So because the AT does go through New York near the city, but I was there for like a few days and then went back on the trail. But I decided I wasn't going to go back to New York because I didn't want distractions. So I remember, and this is how magical, you know, the trail is, I was hiking and I said, man, I know I'm gonna write about the AT. I wish there was a cabin I can go to for like 3 months so I can write a masterpiece, because that's what authors do, right? They go to cabins and write like a bestseller, or where teenagers go to get murdered, right? That's right, one of those two. But so then that's what I wanted, and then like a few days later a hiker family came, they picked us up, and they fed us at a small town, and they said, hey Derick, we heard you're writing about your thru hike. We have a cabin in Pennsylvania. If you want to go there for 3 months for free and start writing, they had no internet or anything like that. Started writing for 3 months in that cabin. And after that, I wanted to still stay away from New York for a bit. So I went and hung out with my mom for a little bit in Pennsylvania. But yeah, I ended up for like the first 5 months after my thru hike, I didn't go back to New York. And also, so I was reliving my AT hike. So it took me 6 months to hike the Appalachian Trail, but I was reliving it while I was writing it and also editing and revising. So for like 2 years, I was reliving the AT. So I didn't revert, like the transition wasn't hard because I kept reliving it. Every day I was writing, I was reliving, talking about it. And then I started doing talks. And I'm reliving it. And to this day, even after writing it, I'm talking about it, sharing it. So it's hard for that to disappear. And now at this point, it's my job, you know, and that's how people see me. And yeah, it's who I am now. The New Yorker that was before the AT is gone.
We got a question. Are you involved in any activities that get youth involved in the outdoors or hiking, and you know, or folks from and maybe from urban areas or other places?
I get there's a few organizations a lot of organizations that reach out to me, and I see what they're doing. There's one in New York City that's doing one. and she's based in Harlem, and I used to live in Harlem, and I did a talk in the YMCA a few years ago. And right before COVID, I had set up a talk, and I was going to, it was going to be for a bunch of kids from like the city that had never heard of the AT. And I was really stoked about it. And then everything shut down, kind of broke my heart. But yes, I'm doing, I'm actually working on a project on a podcast that I'm doing, and I'm making sure that we bring in some, we do a scholarship for these different groups that take kids out that had never seen, you know, trekking poles, or have never seen a tent, or don't know how to put a tent together. So yes, I'm constantly doing that, because I wish little Derick saw someone like me or saw this cover and was like, hey man, you know, what is that? You know, yeah. And I also want to, I want to add that my plans are to write a children's book version of this. And I was going to have it done this year, but I had other projects that kind of like, okay, I need to do that. But I do eventually want to write a children's book version of the Unlikely Thru-Hiker.
Great. Well, I know we get, maybe got time for maybe one or two more questions. So Lena had a question. Do you have any suggestions for ways that those of us that already love the outdoors can make hiking more welcoming to other unlikely hikers?
So I don't know if you mean like, because the main thing that we don't see is we don't see a lot of people of color out there. And at this point, I used to like not wanna, I used to tiptoe around it because I wasn't sure how to approach the situation, like how to approach the issue, because it is an issue. And I constantly get the question, like, how do we get more people of color out there? But you're asking me, how do we get more unlikely hikers or unlikely people that would be that would go outdoors or hike? I say, keep sharing. I would say, keep sharing your passion for it. It's almost like you can't tell a kid to do something. Like, say, you know, I have a kid. I'm like, hey, look, I love going out in the woods. You should do it with me. No, show them how much you love it. If they see how much you love it, then they're going to go, hey, like my brother, like he was like, didn't know anything about it, but he saw my passion for it. He saw that I finished it. All of a sudden he's buying all this gear. Have that passion for it. If you want to see more beautiful people of color, Latino and all that, get yourself some beautiful Black Latino friends and bring them out there, show them what it's about. Let them know that, you know, there's people that you think that are unlikely, but they're not. Give them my book. You know, there's a lot of people like me that are sharing. I see more now, and I'm going to say this, in 2012, I was, and there was like maybe one or two, not many, black organizations that were like kind of promoting the outdoors, not many. Now I see a lot, which is a beautiful thing. So there's a lot now. And I was the first out there and talking. People are like, oh, and that's one of the reasons why my book was published, because I have such a passion for it. And I don't look like your average hiker, but there are a lot out there. So just follow them. If you're doing talks, you know, if you're doing an event, invite them to do talks. If you're not going to that extent, just, again, I'm going to go back to just show them how much you love it, you know, and share stories of other people that they may think is unlikely.
Yeah. Thank you, Derick. Maybe the final question some folks have asked, you know, when you read the book, the people are the trail. They're part of the experience. Do you still keep in touch with your trail family?
I don't like any of them. No. Yeah, man. For real. Like, and it's not just the people that I met that when I through hike that are in the book. It's beyond that. It's when I do my day hikes. It's when I, you know, done weekend hikes. Now that I do talks, and I'm pretty known to, you know, be that voice of the outdoors. People have become friends through that. So I have, yeah, man. Overdrive, I officiated his wedding. So like, you know, I was a minister for a minute for him. I don't know why he trusted me with that, but I made it fabulous. He just said, I get to wear a suit. And I was like, I get to wear a suit. All right, I got this. So yeah, Overdrive and I are still pretty tight. There's two women from Germany that are in the book that I'm still friends with. So yeah, I'm pretty tight with almost everyone from, there was two groups that I hiked with, and then I hiked solo that I'm still pretty tight with. So yeah, I always try to stay in touch with them.
Well, Well, Derick, this was amazing. Thank you so much for taking the time. I know you're super busy, and we're really lucky to have you be part of this event and part of our annual meeting and share your story. And folks, we do have a recording of this, and we'll make it available on the website. Please check out Derick's site. And if you haven't read the book, read the book. It's great. Thank you so much, Derick.
Can I add one more thing?
You bet.
Okay. So I'm thinking, and I'll talk to you guys about this, I'm thinking of thru-hiking the long trail. I'm going to leave it at that.
Okay. We need to make that happen.
No, all right, guys. Thank you for having me.
All right. Take care, Derick.